pleasure to be here today, talk to everybody on this subject. Of course, whenever you talk about Donald Trump, what he's going to do, it's sort of hit and miss. So we'll see if any of my predictions, are borne out by his term in office. He seems to be a guy who is trying to keep some of his campaign promises. And, for example, the ill-advised and slipshod refugee ban and travel ban from seven countries, being a greater friend of Israel, scrapping the Trans-Pacific Partnership trade deal, building a wall and threatening increased tariffs with countries like Mexico and China. He wanted to scrap the Iran nuclear deal, and he wants to take a harder line against Cuba. I think on the last two, he's probably attenuated his remarks or his stances. But some of these policy prescriptions may end up getting him involved in more interventions than he might think. The propensity, of course, in American foreign policy is to get dragged into things that we probably shouldn't get dragged into. For instance, let's take the first one, the Muslim, what is essentially a Muslim ban, and that's how it's seen overseas, whether we want to intend it that way or not. It does anger the Islamic world. The foreign policy establishment is right about that, and anti-U.S. terrorism could increase as a result of it, thereby perhaps prompting ham-handed military retaliation by Trump. Because I think this president may be prone to, as he said about nuclear weapons, why don't we use these more, or something like that. I can't remember exactly what he said about it, but it was rather scary. So he does have sort of an impulsive, bent to his policy. Of course, his advisors try to walk that back and tame him down. But when you're in a crisis, that's not a good characteristic to have, especially if there's nuclear weapons involved. So, he may, if there is terrorism, he may not use nuclear weapons, but he may overdo it. And I think he's been convinced by his former national security advisor, Michael Flynn, that we have to take a hard line against Islamist terrorism. So if he did take a retaliation in response to a terrorist attack, then we go into the cycle where we make things even worse by stoking up terrorists to attack, thereby accelerating the downward spiral. Of course, this happened with the Iraq War with George Bush, but we never seem to learn from our past mistakes in U.S. foreign policy because we just keep making almost the same ones over and over again. Not to mention that this refugee and seven-country ban address a non-existent security situation. Refugees are some of the most vetted people that already come into the United States. And when you have a refugee ban, it sort of resembles what happened during World War II when Franklin Roosevelt turned away ships of Jews who were coming here during the Holocaust and also didn't increase the quotas for European Jews in the immigration quotas. So it's not only looks bad, but it is bad. And I think that no refugee has killed an American since 1980. And the ban on refugees certainly is misplaced. And even these countries have not had a great deal of people coming from them that have caused trouble in the United States. In fact, most of the recent terrorism we've had has been people who either were citizens or already lived here, they're not going to be caught by the ban, most probably. So anyway, this ban has very little security advances, and it can lead to blowback terrorism. Now, of course, foreign policy establishment critiquing Trump on this misses the big glaring thing that this probably, even as bad as this ban is, it probably causes less blowback terrorism than U.S. military intervention overseas, which the foreign policy establishment keeps doing that. We're currently running wars in 7 Muslim countries. None of them, you could probably say that the Afghan war is the only constitutional one. I'm not saying it's advised that we're still in Afghanistan, but at least it was approved in some manner by Congress. There's no declaration of war, but the rest of these wars, it doesn't really matter whether they're declared or not. They're all against Muslim countries. We've got wars in Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Yemen, Somalia, and Libya. And I say at least 7 countries because there may be covert wars going on elsewhere. So this is already, this ban, which is perceived as a Muslim ban, and we'll see what the next, the courts have blocked this version of it. He's coming up with a different version. We'll see how that, what effect that has. But it sort of just adds to the pile of grievances that the Muslim countries have with the United States. Now, the second issue is we just saw Trump and Bibi Netanyahu backslapping at the White House. Trump wants to be a greater friend to Israel because Israel didn't like Obama, even though Obama increased the aid that Israel gets from about $3 billion a year to almost $4 billion per year in military assistance. So I'm not sure that Obama wasn't a great friend to Israel as well. Now, whether that should be an end goal of U.S. foreign policy is doubtful because I think the Palestinians and the Arabs do have a, should have a say. Of course, they're the much weaker party. So Trump has backed off from the explosive move of transferring the U.S. embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. But he apparently is entertaining the idea, at least, of giving up a two-state solution. That is giving the Palestinians their own state. Now, this policy has been the policy of the United States for decades. However, it's largely not going to happen. So maybe Trump is facing reality, but Israel keeps increasing the settlements in this area. And they have no intention, they're the stronger party, they have no intention of stopping that. So, but the U.S., if he does want to broker a Middle East peace, which he seems to want to do, then he's going to have to poke Israel in the ribs, because that's the only way it's going to happen. But so his two initiatives are sort of in opposition to each other. He wants to be a better friend of Israel, but on the other hand, if you want to broker a peace deal, you have to do what Jimmy Carter did, and that is to needle Israel, who is the most reluctant party in the Camp David peace accords, into that. Now, whether the United States should really be doing that, Jimmy Carter did get peace between Egypt and Israel. It took out Israel's most potent enemy, and Israel has been much more secure since then, so Israel should be happy with that. However, Jimmy Carter also had to pay off both sides, and so Israel and Egypt get billions a year in U.S. foreign assistance, as I mentioned. This is a contradiction that Trump has in his Middle Eastern policy. So the question is, should the United States really get involved in this anymore? I don't think it's going to happen. And the latest example of peace in the Middle East, the U.S. wasn't a part of. So when we say we're an indispensable nation in foreign policy, we certainly weren't in the Oslo Agreement during the Clinton administration, because the U.S. got surprised by that. But the parties were able to get some sort of agreement without the United States. And I think probably the U.S. should probably try less to do that. We can't want peace more than the parties do themselves. And really, they don't want peace at this point. I'm going to move down another issue. Trump's trade policy seems to be very protectionist. Now, whether he's just using this as a negotiating position, he seems to use, if if you notice a pattern here, he seems to take an outrageous position, like in Asia, dropping the one China policy, in Europe by saying NATO's obsolete and cozying up to the Russians, and in the Middle East by saying, well, we may abandon the two-state solution. You know, we're not wed to that. And I think he does that because he's, you know, he's a negotiator. And so he thinks if he takes an extreme position, like in, it's reported that he wanted to use the one China policy to move away from that to get China to agree to a good trade agreement that would help the U.S. Or to push North Korea to get rid of their nuclear weapons. Of course, that didn't really work out too well because the Chinese, you know, the Chinese president wouldn't take his call until he said, no, we're going to respect the one China policy. That's very important to China. And of course, the one China policy was the forerunner of that was Richard Nixon and Jimmy Carter in the late 70s, and the Chinese agreed to that. So it's been around for decades too. The two-state solution in the Middle East and the one-state, one-China policy, which of course is we recognize China as, and we don't recognize Taiwan. Yet we still, of course, Taiwan is a country, it's sitting there and we sell a lot of arms to Taiwan, but we just don't formally recognize it. But that's what allows negotiations to happen in East Asia. So he takes these positions hoping to get a good deal. Now, of course, he can cause a lot of turmoil with that, and if that's a strategy that leads to better outcomes, that's fine, but I'm not sure that it necessarily does. For instance, his scrapping of the Trans-Pacific Partnership could cause an international trade war. And also he's said something about raising tariffs on countries such as Mexico and China. This could also increase the possibility of war. Now, of course, there's no guarantee that free trade stops war. Before World War I, the world had that was the first era of free and open trade, and of course we had a massive war, which was the most important event of the 20th century. But I think we can say that free trade probably at least gives a peace lobby in both countries. Business people lose money in wars, societies lose money in wars, and therefore it's good to have free trade. And it's also good to have free trade because it, of course, benefits everyone. And I'm sure in this crowd I don't have to sing the praises of free trade, but I do think it does have some implication on security. I think some libertarians and lovers of liberty overstate the fact that, you know, if we have free trade, we're never going to have another war. But certainly, protectionism has caused war. In 1930, they put on the Smoot-Hawley tariff during the Hoover administration, and that helped work. At minimum, it helped worsen the worldwide Great Depression that helped cause World War II. So, you know, we want to have, I think we do want to have free trade, except that Trump is very protectionist, and certainly he is, you know, trying to cut better deals with these countries, but he's also, I think, very disruptive in existing things like the North American Free Trade Agreement has been destabilized by this and that sort of thing. So, you know, this is one area which you could end up making war more likely if there's more protectionist policies. Now, the next issue is this Iran nuclear deal. Now, is that a good deal or not? Well, it's very technical. And I say that I think it's a very good deal for everybody concerned. Now, it's not perfect. I mean, Iran is only delayed by 10 to 15 years in getting a weapon. It probably, you know, nuclear weapons technology is very old, and it's not really that hard anymore. You have to have, the main key is, you have to have huge amounts of infrastructure to, you know, enrich the uranium. You have to make it into a warhead that's small enough that'll fit on a missile, which of course North Korea has done for short and medium range missiles, but not long range missiles. These things do require technology, but you know, if you put enough effort into them nowadays, the first nuclear weapon was exploded in 1945. So this is not a cutting edge technology anymore, unfortunately, and that's, so Iran could still get a nuclear weapon. However, all the people that, all the countries that were complaining about the Iran nuclear deal were the biggest, really the biggest beneficiaries of it. The Gulf Arab states and Israel both don't like Iran. And if your neighbor was impeded in any way from getting a nuclear weapon, that would be good. And that they are more advantaged than the U.S., which is much farther away. And Iran is going to take a long time to get a weapon that'll they can put on a warhead, and you have to put it on a long-range warhead because it has to be an ICBM. It goes outside the Earth's atmosphere and comes back in. And that's, of course, the key thing that North Korea has not yet been able to do, is the, marry the warhead with the long-range missile. And you also have to develop the heat shield technology because it has to re-enter the Earth's atmosphere, whereas the short- and medium-range missiles, they go a more flat trajectory. So if it does impede nuclear, Iran's nuclear program, which it is, and also one key thing that was, it's, this is a very technical point, but it's very important, which was never in the media. There's two ways of getting a nuclear weapon: enriching uranium and making plutonium. And plutonium is the worst method that you can have, simply because you can pack more power, you can get a smaller, smaller amount will blow up to a larger extent, in other words. And so they're more potent warheads, plutonium warheads. And they've basically shut that down for the Iranians. So this nuclear weapons accord is very beneficial to all countries, including the United States. Now, fortunately, Trump seems to have backed off abandoning it. And he has a problem because there's other signatories to it besides the U.S. It's not just the U.S. and Iran. So this is a positive thing, I think. And it's one thing that he's really moderated on. And I think one thing, I think Michael Flynn was probably the most radical of his advisors. And Michael Flynn is not without merit. I think, and I'll discuss Russia in a moment, but I think it is good to have a better relationship with Russia. And Michael Flynn wanted to do that. But Michael Flynn and also the Secretary of Defense, they have this hatred of Iran. And I think one of the reasons that they do is because they just have the traditional view of the Middle East that Iran is the biggest culprit there. And I think that Iran is a culprit, but there's a lot of other culprits in the Middle East as well. So, and of course, the United States is indirectly cooperating with Iran, although nobody says as much, in the fight against ISIS, because ISIS is a Sunni radical group and the Iranians are Shiites, and therefore, and of course, the U.S. is indirectly cooperating with Russia in that fight as well. Now, Trump has been less talkative lately about taking a harder line against Cuba. In my mind, that's a good thing as well, because the hardline policy towards Cuba has a 60-year period, was a failure. In fact, Obama's policy of trying something new, that is increasing trade, financial flows, and personal contacts over the long term, might eventually open Cuba up. Now, it's going to be a long time before that happens, so we shouldn't be, you know, looking at our watches. And Americans always are impatient to, listen, we got to transform this country. We have to, you know, we have to make them a democracy or whatever. But certainly the period of the 60-year period where the U.S. and isolated, and I say U.S. because a lot of the other countries in the world go, they were trading with Cuba and saying, what, you know, they never accepted our sanctions. So if they trade with Cuba, then, you know, it's really not going to work. You have to have multilateral sanctions, and even they don't work most of the time. Cuba is no threat to the United States anymore, and should probably just be allowed to do its thing. Now, it's a communist country, and that I'm not saying that's a good thing, but, you know, someday the Cuban people are going to revolt and end that. It can't go on forever. And I'm really surprised it's gone on this long, but, you know, the Castros have outlasted, you know, but like 12 or 13 presidents, I think. I'd have to go look up the exact number. But anyway, so I think that the Cuban policy that Obama put in is worth saving, and I also think it's worth the Congress taking off the sanctions that they put on. The other thing about the Trump policies, of course, the one that gets all the publicity, is his creating a better relationship with Russia. I think if that's a good idea, if nothing else, because there's a rising China. And what do you want to do with a rising China? You want to have friends that can help you. And China and Russia are natural enemies. They have a common border. They had a border war in 1969. We are clear a world away from China. And the reason that the British allowed the U.S. to rise peacefully in the 1800s, I'm convinced, was because we had a huge ocean between us. There was no threat there. There may have been some threat to the British Empire, but there was no threat to Britain itself. Now, we have the same situation with China, except the ocean's even bigger. And China is probably doesn't, in its history, it doesn't quite have the imperialist tendencies of Russia. Now, it had some imperialism in its past, but I think it probably wants to be a regional power. Thank you. And so we want this, we might want this counter, a friend to counter China, and China's rising faster. Russia's very weak, and Russia's overplayed in the media. Price of oil is down. The Russian military has a few good units in the special forces, but largely their military isn't that good. And it's only good if it's going up against Ukraine or whatever. But the other thing is that Russia, we may be able to, as Putin says, cooperate against the Islamist terrorism. Now, if we do cooperate with Russia to counter China, this would be the reversal of Nixon's policy in the early 70s, where he decided to, he's the ultimate realist, he decided to cooperate with a more radical communist regime, Mao's regime, against a regime that was the Soviet Union, which was less radical than Mao, but much more powerful. So this is a realistic foreign policy. However, I do think that Russia probably should be punished for interfering with the U.S. elections to deter it and other countries from doing this in the future. I mean, this goes to the heart of our system. It's not the only thing, of course. We have individual rights and freedoms, as you all know. But elections are still important in the United States, and this is sort of a self-defense move. And I think that Obama probably did too little in that regard. We don't know what he did. We know what he did in the overt sphere. Who knows what he did in the covert sphere? So I can't say that for sure. But you know, in the short term, I think we need to tell Russia, don't do that again. And if you do, here's what we're going to do to you. And it's not going to be nice. But in the long term, I think a better relationship with Russia is probably a good idea. And I think Trump's on the right track there. Now, he also has talked about lifting Russian sanctions in exchange for a nuclear deal. Again, this bargaining type of strategy. So who knows if that'll work. I mean, I don't think the sanctions are... Russia wants the sanctions lifted, but I think they're overstating the impact of the sanctions. But if you can trade the sanctions off for a deal on nuclear weapons, that might not be a bad idea either. Another positive development, I think, is that Secretary of Defense Mattis has warned the Europeans to pay more of their own defense expenditures, or the U.S. May attenuate its commitment to NATO. And I think that's true. I noticed that some of the editorials are saying, well, you know, they do need to pay more, but we can't go against our commitment. It just roils the waters too much. And I'm going, well, if you don't threaten them with that, they're never going to pay, because even during the Cold War, there's a thing, and the economists will tell you, in an alliance, there's always a free rider problem. And the small countries, they really take advantage of the large country. And that's what's happening in NATO. There's 28 countries in NATO. We account for 75% of the defense expenditures. And they have this requirement that each country is supposed to spend 2% of its GDP on defense. Well, that doesn't happen. There's only four other countries besides the United States that do that. Most countries in NATO do not even come close to the 2% category. They just rely on the U.S. to defend them in case something happens. You know, this idea that NATO, after 9/11, NATO made a big deal about the only time, and if you go to NATO headquarters in Brussels, and I've been there many times, they always tell you, well, the only time the NATO treaty was ever invoked was after 9/11. And, you know, that's wonderful. It was great publicity. But, I mean, what do they really do? They came with us into Afghanistan. We tend to use these alliances as fig leaves when it's most of the military power in these things is overwhelmingly the United States. In fact, U.S. has become so advanced compared to the European allies that the U.S. military doesn't really like to operate with them because their technology is much more primitive than ours. So this is a problem, and if you don't threaten them with this, they're not going to pay up. And so I think that's one of the positive things that Trump is doing. And he's also made noises about doing that to Japan and South Korea, where there's the same problem. All these countries are rich now. The original conception of the alliance, and Eisenhower said, if we still have troops in Europe, after a few years here, we're going to fail. Well, he said that in the 1950s. So the problem is when we take troops places, they just kind of stay around all the time. And these are now all rich countries, both in East Asia, in the Middle East with Israel versus the poorer Arab countries, and in Europe. And these people all really need to pay more for their own defense instead of freeloading under the U.S. defense and nuclear umbrella. And what they do is they use the money saved in defense. Defense is a drag on your economy, contrary to all the Keynesians who think otherwise. And the money they use, they save on defense expenditures, they pump back into their economies, of course, competing with our firms, et cetera. And loosening of the defense ties is not necessarily a bad move. The main threat of the Cold War is long over with this. Russia is still a shadow of the Soviet Union. The United States is giving up its independence. Our allies have become an end in themselves. We're supposed to use an ally, and the founders of the country said that you shouldn't get into permanent or entangling alliances. And of course, we're not only in permanent entangling alliances, we're using them as an end point. That's a good thing. We have to support our allies. Well, our allies are supposed to be an alliance is supposed to be a way to improve your own security, and if your independence is constricted. And here I'm going to go into the next segment here by illustrating what an alliance can drag you into. I'll just say that I think Trump is right. NATO is obsolete. It should have gone away after the Cold War has ended. Instead, it expanded eastward, and it also turned from a defensive alliance defending the Western Europe into an offensive alliance projecting places to places like Libya, Afghanistan, Kosovo, which were not anywhere near the NATO treaty area of Western Europe. And of course now, what do we get for that? Well, we have a Putin and Russia's probably going to have an autocratic leader. We want him to have a democracy, but Russia has a very poor intrinsic security situation, and this never gets mentioned when we talk about what they did in Crimea or Eastern Ukraine. The Russians, there's a flat Northern European plain which goes from France across Germany to through Poland, Ukraine, right into Russia. Russia has been invaded many times in its history, twice by the Mongols, the Swedes, the Poles, the Germans, Napoleon, the French, and of course the Germans was Hitler. The last invasion of Russia killed 25 million Russians. Now in World War II, there were 25 million Russians killed and 5 million Germans, and the Germans lost the war. Most of the fighting, heavy fighting, was on Russian soil, and the Russians stopped the Germans, and the war was pretty much over with It wasn't totally over, but it was pretty much, we knew who was going to win when we hit the beaches of Normandy. And of course, you don't hear that in U.S. history very much. But the Russians, they're very paranoid about their Western approaches, and that's why they do what they do. We've run the NATO alliance right up to the Baltics, and it's right on their border. And no country we're just convinced that the NATO alliance is benevolent and that we're not going to attack Russia and that sort of thing. But you have to remember their history. And so things can turn south, and now I'm not defending Putin, but you're probably going to get an autocrat in Russia simply because the intrinsic security situation is so bad that power centralizes. We have the luxury, liberty here in this country. Well, we got our liberty from England. The reason the English started the ball rolling in modern times was the fact that they lived on an island. They had a moat around it. They traditionally had a small army, which armies undermine liberty. Navies, not so much, because they're out floating around conquering other people, and that's what the British Navy did. But it was very good for liberty at home to have a small army. Well, we had a small army for most of our history, and of course we have wider moats than the English Channel. And of course we've gotten away from that after World War II. We went away from the founders' foreign policy, and now we're policing the world, and we have a huge military, a peacetime military. And of course, if you read the Constitution very carefully, you'll realize that the Army and the Air Force are probably unconstitutional, because the Constitution really doesn't authorize a standing army. It authorizes a standing navy. It says you'll raise armies, plural, and you'll maintain a navy. And so, that's the mentality. We've always been a sea power, and that's why our security situation is the opposite. We probably have the best intrinsic security position in world history for a great power, because we have two great moats, the oceans. We have weak and friendly neighbors, Mexico and Canada, and we also have the most capable nuclear arsenal on the planet. Nobody is going to not only invade us, but probably attack us. Except for some terrorist groups, and this terrorism is brought on by ourselves, a lot of it, because we're intervening in Islamic countries, and we have done so since World War II. So now I want to go to give an example. I'll talk about the policy in East Asia with China. Now, of course, Trump, has now had to drop his opposition to the One China policy that he was going to use to negotiate with China to get either a trade agreement or to get them to pressure North Korea. And the problem with our policy in East Asia is that we have all these allies which can drag us into a war with China. And China's made these territorial claims in the East China Sea and the South China Sea, which are pretty extensive. And they run up against claims by the Philippines, by Vietnam, by Japan in the East China Sea. And they're really fighting over literally rocks in the ocean. And the Chinese have built these military facilities on these rocks. But other countries have built them too, which you never hear about in the papers or in the news. And our alliances with Japan and the Philippines can end up dragging us into a nuclear war, because China has nuclear weapons, and they have the nuclear weapons that can hit the United States. They have about 21 ICBMs at least that can hit the United States. And therefore, one wonders why we would want to get dragged into this. In a war, these are no threat to the United States. They could be taken out, these military facilities on the rocks. And China is not going to, is unlikely to impede trade through that area, the South China Sea especially, and the East China Sea, because they're a big trading nation. They're going to, if they do that, other countries are going to have their ships, military ships there, and it's going to be a war, and they don't need that because they're a major trading nation. That's the one thing I think that China has that the Soviet Union didn't have. The Soviet Union didn't have anything anybody wanted to buy because of their communist system. The Chinese, of course, still have their communist system in nominally, but they've at least opened their economy in certain respects. So, you know, they're in some ways they're more dangerous because of that, I suppose, but also they have an incentive to play by the system to not block sea lanes, et cetera. So the question is, why do we really want to get involved in these disputes in the East China Sea and South China Sea? But of course, we say, well, we're neutral in the disputes, but we have our allies are involved in the disputes, so we're not really neutral in the disputes. And the question is, why do we really need to be so far forward? We need to wean our allies off our defense, and they need to do more for their own defense. And I don't even think Trump's suggestion that Japan and South Korea get nuclear weapons was as outrageous as everybody else thought, simply because if you want to have a country get nuclear weapons, would you rather have it to have the North Korea or Pakistan, or would you rather have it to be Japan or South Korea? These countries have been in the international system and good players in the international system now for decades. And so if they had their own nuclear deterrent, just like the British and the French do in NATO, would that be such a bad idea? Maybe not. The trade war, of course, I've already mentioned, it hurts U.S. economically, and I think U.S. workers, frankly, should stop blaming foreign people for losing their jobs. It's technology that's the culprit, and they really just need to get retrained and compete in the free market. And I think a trade war also does, as I mentioned before, increase the probability that we could have a war with China, and it's really unnecessary to do that. So China is a bit like Iran. You know, everyone always says, well, Iran could close the Strait of Hormuz, so we have our Navy over there. Iran has no desire to close the Strait of Hormuz, since most of its oil is export, and that's its major export by far. So they have no incentive to close the Strait of Hormuz at the bottom of the Persian Gulf, because all their oil goes out of there too. So when our military makes up all these threat scenarios, they always do the worst case, and they'll tell you they do that because that's their job, right? But we don't always have to accept the fact, and I don't mind if they do that, but I think because our society's become so militarized and nothing, the military can't really, isn't really given a lot of criticism, which of course they could be since they've lost the last couple wars they've been in, Iraq and Afghanistan, but they're not, and therefore I think a lot of times our policy is based on military factors, when in fact countries like Iran, China, they have no incentive to cut off these economically beneficial routes, sea routes. And we're always intervening with our Navy saying, well, we're sticking up for freedom of navigation. Well, the freedom of navigation, which wasn't really threatened, so these things, these alliances that we have left over from the Cold War in Asia as well as in Europe can really undermine our independence of foreign policy and can get us dragged into wars that we really don't want to. And of course, we all know that war is the biggest cause of big government in human history and in American history. And if you doubt that, a lot of the major social programs were born during warfare, and the government intervention in the economy first started in World War I and got worse in World War II. And of course, when people see some advantage like farm subsidies, saying, oh yeah, well, we made a lot of money during that war. Well, why don't we continue these policies in peacetime? So, wars centralize power and they cause big government. So I think we need to pay attention to that. Now, Trump has pledged not to get bogged down in as many foreign wars, but yet some of his policies, as I mentioned, may drag him there anyway. For instance, he has said, well, he's favored establishing safe zones in Syria. Well, that could cause unnecessary conflict with Russia. And frankly, I think we've been wise to stay out of that conflict. There's a guy, I used to work out at the National Security Agency, and the head of the National Security Agency during the Reagan administration was a tough old general named William Odom, and he was giving a talk, which I attended one time, long after he retired. He said, during the Iraq War, he was really one of the only generals that came out and said, I'm against this war, because all the other generals were scared to say that. And he said, I'm against going to war with Iraq because it's bad to start a war that helps your strategic enemy, whether you win it or not. And he said, I was against the Vietnam War for the same reason. It helped the communists. And he said, it's good. This war is going to help the Iranians. And so I think that's why it's good to stay out of a lot of things until you really need to. Now, if there, you know, there's a legitimate threat, okay, then we need to use the troops and do that. But I think since we do have an intrinsically good security position and geography still matters, then, you know, such as getting dragged into safe zones in Syria, that just gets you dragged in. You have to protect the zone. You're going to run into conflicted routes with Russian aircraft. What if we get into it like the Turks and the Russians almost got into it? They've mended their fences now, but the Turks shot down a Russian aircraft over Syria at the it was right at the Turkish-Syrian border. So you can get dragged into these things pretty easily. Again, another example, U.S. military is now asking for more troops for the war in Afghanistan. Well, the war was lost a long time ago, and if you can't beat the Taliban in 16 years, you're not going to do it in 40 years. It's their country. They got plenty of time, and they'll outwait you. The Vietnamese outlasted the Japanese, the French twice, and the Americans over a number of decades to win their independence. And, you know, Ho Chi Minh was less of a communist than the people were just fed up with foreign occupations. Unfortunately, you know, they had a communist system, and they still do in Vietnam. It's eased a little bit, but not as much as in China. But that the reason for that is because it was really nationalism with a communist veneer. And if the Western powers had different policies, perhaps the communists wouldn't have taken over there. But this is the same in Afghanistan. I think that you know, you can't beat people who are willing. It's their country. It's not our country. So they're willing to stay around as long as they have to you know, do whatever they do. And I'm certainly no fan of the Taliban. Their human rights is atrocious. They're just one step short, I think, of ISIS. But, you know, you just can't go in and remodel countries. We haven't been able to do it in 16 years. So the military is asking Trump for more troops there. You know, the problem is he doesn't know a lot. And I think he has some good instincts, but, you know, the military publicly put Obama in a bad position by requesting more troops for Afghanistan. So we'll see. Trump appears to be stronger willed than that, but Trump could be just convinced that it's a good idea. But he does have some. He has said he doesn't want to get involved in as many wars. And as I mentioned, we've got 7 wars going in the Middle East. Here's some of our foibles. The U.S. government originally unintentionally created al-Qaeda by giving aid to Islamist freedom fighters in Afghanistan in the 1980s, and they also created ISIS by invading Iraq. Worldwide terrorism increased after George W. Bush invaded Iraq. The U.S. coalition overthrew Muammar Gaddafi in Libya, and now we have chaos and a safe haven for terrorists there. And of course, Obama did that after he saw what happened in Afghanistan and Iraq, which was amazing. In Yemen, studies showed that al-Qaeda grew after the U.S. started air attacks. In Somalia, G.W. Bush helped create the al-Shabaab terror group by sponsoring an Ethiopian invasion of the country. The Afghan war, our intervention in Afghanistan, has destabilized Pakistan with Islamic terrorism, and it's the most dangerous country on earth. I think maybe even, well, North Korea is close, but the problem is North Korea has control over their nuclear weapons. If Pakistan, with these Islamist terrorists running around, if they ever got any of those weapons there, you'd have a combination of terrorists and a nuclear arsenal in the same place. And of course, they have no incentive like a country with a home address where you can hold them hostage with that. The terrorists don't care. So I think, you know, that's another. We've destabilized Pakistan, and that was a very bad idea. If you'll remember, ISIS, the most diabolical group perhaps ever, didn't start beheading Westerners until the U.S. started bombing their territory. So we do have, you know, there's a cause and effect. We always erase the cause of some policies. And I'm certainly not endorsing ISIS as a group. They're horrible, but I think we created them inadvertently, and now we fuel them with some of our policies. So I think we've just, you know, inadvertently blundered down the road on this thing. So now whether Trump actually knows that U.S. military intervention in Islamic countries increases U.S. anti-U.S. terrorism is an open question. I think Obama had some inkling of this, but still was an interventionist president, and G.W. Bush had no clue at all as to that this was occurring. Now, we can only hope that Trump learns this, but Flynn was a very anti-ISIS hawk, and I'm not sure the hawkish policy is the way to go to battle ISIS. So hopefully now that Flynn is gone, perhaps Trump will learn his lesson there, although it doesn't seem like it at this point. And, you know, we always get dragged into, the presidents are just, I'm going to stop my presentation here with the thought I started out with. U.S. foreign policy establishment tends to drag presidents into wars that they may not want to go into. Now, sometimes, like the Iraq War, that was the reverse. But I think in most cases, they say, well, here's a problem. What should the U.S. do about it? And of course, we should ask, well, is it our problem? Would it be better for regional countries to, and less objectionable in the region, for other countries to be the first line of security there? Perhaps if it gets really big, then we can jump in. But, hopefully Trump will be able to avoid this pressure. I'm skeptical because I think Washington almost always tames these reformers when they come in. And I'm putting the quotes on because I'm not sure Trump, he may want to reform the system, but I'm not sure he has the right policies in total. Some of his policies are fine and some are not, but we'll see what happens with the pressure he's going to get to do intervention. So I think he's got some good instincts, but he doesn't know a lot, and I think he can be bamboozled by people who purport to know more than he does. Any questions?
Okay, so my question is, a lot of times you hear with respect to like Russia that, oh, Russia invaded Crimea, which I think is kind of incomplete. So can you talk about the events leading up to the Russian intervention in Crimea, and then to how should Trump kind of work out the Ukraine issue broadly?
Yeah, I think, you know, we'd sort of get a one-sided viewpoint. I'm not for countries invading other countries. Of course, Crimea was always part of Russia, and Khrushchev during the 1950s gave it back to Ukraine. But of course, Ukraine was in the Soviet Union then. So all the people speak Russian there, and they would rather be in Russia. So it's not like they're subduing people that don't want to live there. But still, international boundaries are international boundaries, I guess. You should probably negotiate changes to that. But what happened in the Ukraine was, the Russians had a friendly government there. The G.W. Bush made noises about incorporating Ukraine into NATO, and that's what's caused all this. You'll never hear that either, but that is really true. Ukraine is very critical to Russia over its history. It was an industrial center when it was part of the Soviet Union, and it was an agricultural center. A lot of the Soviet Union's agriculture came from the Ukraine, and the industrial part is in the eastern part there. And so, and of course, there's cultural commonality between Ukrainians and Russians, at least in the eastern part. All those are Russian-speaking areas that Russia is meddling about in now. And what happened was they had a pro-Russian government in Ukraine, but they had street riots and protests. And of course, the Russians say that the CIA were behind them. Now, nothing has ever come out about that, but the CIA has destabilized a lot of places, so Maybe they were involved, maybe they weren't. But anyway, the Russians regarded this as an illegitimate regime change. It was not done by voting or anything else. It was just sort of a people's coup. And so that government that they put in there after this people's coup was pro-Western. Well, that alarmed the Russians because of Ukraine's importance. And I think that's why Putin decided if there's going to be a pro-Ukrainian government, and I have to get the naval base in Crimea. That's why he did that. It's the Russians have always historically had a problem that they never had a warm water port. Most of their ports are iced up during the winter, and their winter is very long there. So this thing in the Black Sea, which tends to be further south, is very important. There's a naval base, and the Russians were leasing this naval base from the Ukraine, but it's always been the Russian fleet that was there during the Soviet period and even afterwards when Ukraine had it, Crimea, because they had this lease on this base. So I think what happened was when Ukraine got a pro-Western government, Putin says, I got to get what I can get out of this, and I'm going to take Crimea, take the naval base, and I'm also going to destabilize the eastern port of Ukraine, which has a lot of Russian people in it and possible supporters and fighters, which he has been able to get, because he doesn't want Ukraine to be in NATO, because Ukraine is also part of that flat plain. Poland is the other country, and Belarus, all those countries right there, very critical in the near abroad for their security because there's been so many invasions through that. So Russia does have a perspective. Now, we might not always want to accept their perspective, but they are guarding their near abroad, and great powers have always done that. I mean, we have the whole Western Hemisphere, the Monroe Doctrine. We've ruthlessly policed that throughout our history since 1823. So I don't think you can argue with spheres of influence. You know, we hear these politicians say, well, spheres of influence are so outdated in the modern world. No, they're not. People just pretend they're not. And so, you know, Russia, it's bad when you can't necessarily condone Russia's behavior invading Crimea, but I think you have to be at least a little empathetic with the Russian security situation. And you should not run a hostile alliance right up on their borders like we have in the Baltics. And oh, by the way, how are you going to defend the Baltics? They're virtually indefensible. We've signed up to defend all these countries. You'd have to run carriers over there, but the Russians will dominate you because land-based air, if you're having a war, don't use aircraft carriers unless you're in the Pacific where there's no land bases, because military power can be delivered best by the Air Force in times of war, because they have larger planes, they take off from longer runways, and that sort of thing. So Russia would dominate any conflict on the Balkans because we would have to bring aircraft carriers, and they would have land-based air. We had one more question here.
Hi. Yes, yeah. Well, first of all, I want to thank you for your speech. I thought it was really informative. I guess my question is kind of related to the culture of war, because we know like politics is a lagging indicator of culture, and it seems that since trade and social interaction have become more globalized and regionalized, at least for now, the threat of war looks very different, right? Like you were mentioning how we have bases all over the world, but the justification for that has been that war has changed. You know, we have digital warfare, biological warfare. It's much easier now for at least non-state actors, you know, to cause violent action in a country across the world. And so that's been at least the proposed justification for us policing the world. Now, how do we get, as Americans, get more people to understand that we're not fixing that threat abroad because we're used to regional protection, and Trump's kind of spurring that up as a real politic thinker. You know, he's coming back into this idea that we need to protect the Western Hemisphere, and his withdrawing from NAFTA and withdrawing from trade agreements with Latin America could potentially cause military conflict like we saw in the 90s in Latin America. How do we criticize his rhetoric and make people realize he is an interventionist, but just a different type of interventionist that we haven't seen in decades, and my generation hasn't seen as a president.
Well, you're absolutely right. I was talking about in the security area, he's a trade interventionist, or at least he seems like he's going to be. And we do have this cyber war, but I think that we can't justify our bases overseas on the basis of anti-terrorism, although we're doing that, or cyber war. I mean, if we didn't want to do cyber war, I mean, we did one of the first cyber attacks. Israel and the United States sabotaged the Iranian nuclear program. Now, we may not like Iran, but that's sort of old baggage. I mean, they're in a rough neighborhood. The Gulf Arab states don't like them. Israel doesn't like them. They're saying, hey, we're getting these nuclear weapons for our own protection, and we distrust them and that sort of thing. But you know, if we don't want cyber war, then we shouldn't practice ourselves, really. So you can say, well, why do we do that? And I think, we have a legitimate complaint against Russia for interfering in our election. And that's a bad thing. And we should do something about that. But I don't think cyber warfare is an excuse for international, I mean, what do you, you know, we could invest in cyber warfare capabilities, but we don't need bases all over. That's physical bases, right? The other thing, biological, the alleged weapons of mass destruction, nuclear, biological, and chemical, there's only one category of weapons that's really a weapon of mass destruction, and that's nuclear weapons. Chemical weapons, they're usually used on the battlefield defensively, because you don't want to go through your own slime, right? If your troops are attacking. Biological weapons are really not good battlefield weapons. They're more a terror weapon, but you know, the Shinrikyo, the Japanese terror group in 1995, they had a bunch of PhDs working, and they couldn't master the chemical or the biological weapons because they did a Tokyo subway attack that was really only killed a few people, and it should have killed a lot more. And so biological, those types of attacks, I think they're very overrated. So we really have to ask ourselves why we're in the Middle East anymore. We should have asked ourselves that a long time ago, because the free market's the best way to get the oil. We pay more to defend the oil than the oil is worth. And now we have fracking here. So even if you're talking about energy security, which I think is nonsense, we have the oil right here. So all the reasons for us intervening in the Middle East are really bad now. And I think also in East Asia and Europe.